worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. Our God, He holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout.
Good morning. Seth Snyder in there gloating in the kitchen to Julie, his 49ers beat her Packers. Probably a little gloating going on. Good morning to those who are at home, who may be traveling, wherever you are. Please join me for the call to worship. Christ is calling us as disciples. We will be led into fields of mission and service. Listen for Christ's call to us. Let us sing our hymn of praise.
Light of the world, you step down into So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became born. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven, because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, well I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. You are my King. You are my King. Jesus, you are my King. Jesus, you are my King. my joy to honor you. Amazing love, amazing love. How can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you in all I do. I honor you in all I do. I honor you.
It's weird, Kevin. You were sitting there, but it sounded like you were up here. Next week, you're going to be up here, and it's going to be someone else singing, right? It's going to be a whole show. We come now to our times of joys, concerns, prayer requests, and I know there are a lot. It's amazing how many there are this morning. Are there any that you all have to share, whether online or if you're here in person? Dr. Dave?
My friend I've told you about that had the thyroid cancer, he has a rare form of the thyroid cancer. There's only 1 in 10 people get it, and he's had a lot of reactions to the chemotherapy and so forth, and it's affected his vision. He's can hardly. He was supposed to go to the optometrist this week and see about his vision, but I don't really know what that came out, but his vision is very poor, and he's stopping the chemotherapy, so I don't know what's going to happen with that. And we are leaving tomorrow for vacation, and we're going to Mississippi first and stay with Brenda for a couple of days and see how she's doing. So we can report back on that 1st of March when we get back when the sun's shining.
Or you can just have your wife message me.
Yeah, whatever. I don't do that.
Yeah, I know. But we definitely continue to keep him in our prayers and give Brenda our love and let us know how she's doing. How much 49ers gear can you wear this morning, Seth?
I just say you don't want to know the answer.
Could be more. Oh, he's even got the socks, the jersey, the hat, the coat. Could have done more. I did message him and Jolie last night and told them they needed to be nice to each other before the game started. She still hugged, because she's a nice person. Had you lost, I'm not sure it would have gone the other way. You wouldn't be here. Fair enough. I don't want to hear about Duke right now, Dave. My soul hurts. My soul. Any others? Mr. Kevin?
So
Definitely. Thank you. For those at home, Kevin was just sharing that his brother-in-law, Mike Luce, has started his treatment, and hopefully next week it won't do that. That's the hope, right? That Mike has started his treatment, and that we continue to keep him in our prayers. Are there any others? Marsha, Barb Moon was in the hospital. Is she still or is she home? I'm just talking about this morning where she is. I feel like this is going to be too much, so I'm just going to.
In and out of the hospital, she was really hoping that 2024 would not be that way, but she was in the hospital last week. No, that was, yeah. And then, yeah. And then she was back at the hospital Friday night because she fell, but luckily she did not break anything. She just severely bruised things. So she is home.
Okay. As of this morning, she is home. Yes. Continue to pray for her. For those of you who can't see at home, Diana Harvey is here. You're feeling better?
Yeah.
Lots better. All right. Well, you're here, so we're hoping. Anyone else? Anyone online?
Yes. Martin Kohler's asked prayer for a friend who has also been diagnosed with cancer. We're praying for Martin, for your friend.
Definitely. We're also praying for Martin, who's been battling a clot in his leg. So prayers for you, our dear friend Martin. Okay, I feel like we also want to keep Irene in our prayers, and she's probably at home going, what? Her other hip was bothering her, and she got an injection, but it doesn't seem to be helping much. So Roy and Irene want you to know that they miss you all, that there is a gap right here, but that they hope to be back soon. Nancy Stevens also has been having some health issues, and so she and JC battled COVID together last week. You imagine how much fun that was at home with a 16-year-old. So that's a good time. Carol Chambers' uncle David had to have hip surgery, but she said that he is doing all right. We saw her the other night at the board meeting, which also happened to be the day of her birthday. Larry Moore had been in the hospital. He had COVID, I know. Did he also have pneumonia? Yeah. They think, yeah. He has been released home on oxygen. I know Winoka has helped him. Larry has seen him. Bill has seen him. And so if you want to give Larry a call or send him a card, I'm sure he would appreciate that. He might have a new number since you last checked. So check with Natalie to make sure you have the right one. We also want to keep Bill Beck in our thoughts and our prayers. Bill is having a procedure, on Thursday? Thursday. And so we want to keep you in our prayers, Mr. Beck, my neighbor. Also want to keep John Martin in our prayers. Of course, all of you know John. I don't think there's a person here that doesn't. Angie's brother, if you don't. They did find a new spot, is it glioblastoma? Am I saying that right? Not a doctor. They did find a new spot, and so he's supposed to have surgery, I think in a couple weeks is what they're hoping. And so definitely keep John and Angie and the rest of the family in your thoughts and prayers as he deals with this. And I think I came to the last person on my list. Her name is Julie Hicks. First of all, we're very grateful you're here this morning, ma'am. If you don't know, Julie had a slide off on 69 on black ice. She wanted to be like the UPS driver in front of her. It was UPS, right? FedEx. She wanted to be like the FedEx driver in front of her and just slide off for fun. No. Slid on black ice, and the barriers and the wires stopped her truck from going. We're very grateful you were in your truck and not your cheetah mobile. She's all banged up, but she's here this morning. X-ray showed a broken thumb, and she'll see our own Dr. Edwards on Tuesday to hopefully get that casted, hopefully no surgery, fingers crossed. Where's Ronnie? Somewhere. Yeah, Ronnie's supposed to be doing all the dishes and all the housework, I heard. So just reinforce that. So, are there any others? Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, thank you for this morning. God, we know that we gather this morning in a crowd that is smaller. God, we know that the weather hinders people. God, we know we weren't here last week because of the frigid wind chill. But God, we also know that wherever we are, you are. God, we are always in communion with you. God, we have this list of prayer concerns this morning. People who have been ill, those who have an illness that they've been dealing with for a long time. God, people who have been dealing with grief. God, those who are scared of what the future might hold. But God, we know that you are with each and every person named this morning. God, we know that your spirit wraps around them and us. That no matter what we face, no matter how hurt we are, how confused we might get, how scared we may be, God, we know that there is hope in your Son, who every day when we wake up calls us into discipleship. God, every day is a newness of life in you. So even when we're doing the same old, and we feel that life may be a bit mundane, God, every day is new in you. And God, we know that there are things on our hearts and minds unmentioned this morning. God, we know that there are things that we deal with that we don't want to discuss with other people. Or maybe we feel like we can't discuss with other people. And so in a time of silent prayer, we lift up to you those things right now. God, hear our prayers. God, those of us who were here for the recovery court graduation this last week heard a story of a mother, of a daughter who died because of her addiction. But God, who came back and who has dedicated her life to you. God, what a powerful testimony. God, may we continue to hear the cries of our neighbors. God, may we continue to reach out in your love and help in the ways we can. It may seem like such a little thing that we offer a space for a graduation, but God, people wouldn't have heard that testimony otherwise. And so, God, we give thanks that we're able to serve our community through you. We pray all of this in the name of your Son, Jesus the Christ, who taught his disciples to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you.
This morning's scripture is Mark 1, 14 to 20. The beginning of the Galilean ministry. And after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the good news of God and saying, The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news. Jesus calls the first disciples. As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, Follow me, and I will make you fish for people. And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. Immediately he called to them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. How many of you like to fish? Show of hands. Hands higher. I know Dr. Dave does. Natalie and I tried to reach him one day and he was at the lake. He said, oh, yeah, you're not finding me there. So, even though I went fishing a lot as a kid, my dad loved to fish. I was never really good at it, and I know this may shock you, but I had no patience for it. People tell me I'm patient, and I don't understand, because I'm not at all. But I had no patience. What am I supposed to be doing, right? I remember being on a camping trip with a friend, probably sixth grade, Her parents had one of those pull behind campers, and they'd go out to, anyone been to Summit Lake in Henry County? Good old Summit Lake? No? Yeah? I would say these people right here used to reside in the area. Larry, you've been? So we would go to Summit Lake, you know, on the weekends when her parents were off. And I thought it was cool because we didn't do that. And basically her parents would just sit around the fire and drink most of the time. And we'd ride bikes and we could do whatever we want, right? It was fantastic. I had all the freedom of the campground. Well, I baited my hook. It was just me and my friends. And I baited my hook and somehow I went to cast my line. From what I understand, your hand, your opposite hand, should not also be part of it while you're casting, right? Kevin, seems logical. I ended up with the bait and the hook through my finger and had to receive dockside first aid from her dad. And forever I thought that, I can relate, Paul, forever I thought that there was bait inside my hand, and it freaked me out. One time I decided to go fishing, night fishing with my dad and my older brothers. My older brothers, had four of them, and they were ages like 13 to 19 when I was born, right? My oldest brother is old enough to be my dad. There's your math lesson for today. So I was in elementary school at the time, and all my brothers were significantly older. And my mom kept saying, are you sure you want to go? Are you sure you want to go? You won't get bored. Like, there's no light. Like, really, you can't read a book. They don't want you taking a book along. And I'm like, I want to go. My dad's like, she'll be fine. What I didn't realize, because, you know, I was a kid, is that I would literally just sit there in the dark with maybe a flashlight if my brothers didn't have it, not being able to see anything on land, anything in the water, and just listening to my older brothers tell jokes I probably should have never heard in my entire life. Hadn't really thought it through. And about 45 minutes in, I decided to leave my pole with my brother Tony, who was 13 years older than I was, and I went off chasing lightning bugs, only to return when he said, hey, there's something on your line, for which I claimed credit for. Right? Because it was my line. And they let me when we got home, like a good dad and brothers. It's a good thing my livelihood and my family's livelihood has never depended on my ability to fish, right? Unlike Simon, Andrew, James, and John. I'm just curious, because fishermen usually tell tales. Show of hands if your family's livelihood depended on your fishing, if your family would eat. Oh, at least we don't have any liars in church this morning. Once in a while. Might have a meal once a month, right, Kevin? But they're fishermen by trade. This is a family business. And the beginning of this morning's scripture is titled, The Beginning of the Galilean Ministry. So we know where we are. I like it when it tells us where we are. We're in Galilee. Now it's a region and a sea. And so the size of Galilee is a pretty large province. There's a lot of potential land for Jesus to cover during his ministry there. And he does when we follow him through the Gospels, right? Verses 14 and 15 tell us, Now after John was arrested... Right, John the Baptist. Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the good news of God and saying, The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news. Which is the same wording as who used? John the Baptist. Isn't that? So as he went along, the Gospel of Mark is the fast-moving gospel. Right? It's the action gospel. It is like the comic book gospel. Jesus is doing all kinds of things. There is no time for the birth narrative of Jesus. Why? Because Mark figures you already know he was born. You got that from someone else. You heard about it. And if he's telling you about Jesus, you should assume he was born, right? He's got no time for the shepherd or the wise men. There's a reason why during Christmas we don't spend time with Mark. The writer of Mark jumps right into the proclamation and ministry of John the Baptist, followed by the baptism of Jesus, both of which we did 2 weeks ago, right? Talking about the importance of John the Baptist for the ministry of Jesus. And then Mark tells us about the temptation of Jesus after that, which we will cover in just a few weeks during Lent. And so we last see John the Baptist in Mark 1:8, where he's telling his followers that he's baptized them with water, right? But there is one Jesus we know who will baptize them with the Holy Spirit. And so it helps as Jesus goes along that he uses some of that same language that John the Baptist did. Doesn't mean he stole it, doesn't mean it's not true. But what it does do is John says, there's one coming. And that helps them figure that out if they've heard John the Baptist before. Again, doesn't mean it's not true from Jesus. Well, John has created some trouble for himself. But Mark doesn't really get into that at this moment, right? He's just created some trouble for himself being the forerunner for Christ and a mouthpiece against the empire. And so we get to today's text just 6 verses later, and we're told that he's been arrested. Again, Mark doesn't care about all the details. He figures we'll find those out eventually or from someone else. We just need to know that John has been arrested, and this is a big deal. He's locked up by the empire. What we do know is that he will never see the light of day again. Jesus makes this trip to Galilee in this context, and he's proclaiming the good news, the gospel of John, the word of God. The gospel of God, the word of God. He's saying, John, right, was talking about me. When John, if you heard him speak, just in case you heard him, if you heard my cousin John speak, it's about me. And as to where John has been silent, Jesus is talking now more than ever. Jesus talks about the kingdom of God. Jesus is bringing a message of Kairos to the Galileans. Remember that Kairos is about God's timing, not about people's timing, not about the empire's timing. No one cares about Caesar's timing when it comes to Kairos. It's about a moment of truth, challenge, and decision. In Mark 1:15, Jesus is saying, the time has come, the Kairos has come. God's time has come. And it's time to realize that we live in a world of crisis and instead need to live in the realm of God, live in the love of God, instead of all that crap that the empire has to offer. What we don't know is who Jesus is telling all of this to and in what setting. Mark isn't one for details, so we'll never know. Is there a crowd around Jesus? Or is he literally just walking around going, hey, Joe, gotta tell you something. Susie, I gotta tell you something today, right? Oh, look, there's Seth. Oh, look, there's Diana. Or is there a crowd? We don't know. It's very Mark-like fashion that we just get the important points, the action words, the call to action. So Jesus is passing along the Sea of Galilee, walking around. And again, we don't know if he's looking for disciples at this point, or does he just see these people and say, yes, yes. So he sees Simon and his brother Andrew, and they're casting their nets into the sea. And these fishermen are just doing their jobs. This is a mundane thing, right? This is an everyday thing. This is like, Seth, what time do you go into work? 8? You go in at 8 o'clock, right? and you do what you do every morning at 8 o'clock, right? George, when you taught, you go in and you prep, right? You got to have that time before. I'm guessing you didn't just walk in the door and start teaching. You may, I don't know your George, you may have. But, so you did your thing, right? You had a routine. We all have a routine, whether it's at home or work, right? So they're just doing their routine, their lives. And Jesus sees them, and he walks up to them and says, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And they immediately drop their nets and follow him. No questions asked. Did they hear Jesus talk before about the kingdom of God and the good news before this encounter? Did he say anything else to them that the writer of Mark and the other gospels might not know about? We don't know. We just know that he tells them that he will make them fish for people. And they're like, yes, we will totally do that. We will leave our livelihoods and our stability right here, and we will follow you. And then we're told he walks a little farther, and he sees James and John. And we're told in verse 19 that they're in their boat mending their nets. Because you can't just go buy new nets all the time. That's expensive. So they're mending their nets. And immediately Jesus says, "Hey, James and John, come with me. I will make you fish for people." And immediately they leave their father and the hired men, and they follow Jesus, and they leave this boat to fish. James and John are leaving their livelihood and security behind, and we've shown that they literally leave their father behind there in the boat. Now, I think the calling of all the disciples is poignant, and there's something to be said about the first disciples being called, right? But I just want you to close your eyes for a second. Imagine, especially if you went fishing with your father as a kid, right? Imagine you're sitting in a boat, and this is your livelihood, and someone says, "Come and follow me." And you hop out of that boat, and you say, "See you later, Dad." Open your eyes. It's interesting. Like, the vision of that is, I think, far more powerful for me than when he calls the first two brothers. They literally leave their family immediately because Jesus says this time is important. This is a time for action. But this calling on them impacts their family. More than likely, their father will need to replace them, and he'll have to replace them with hired people. My guess is they don't get paid a daily wage, right? Because this is a family business. Anyone who's ever worked a family business knows you probably don't get paid like everyone else. So he'll have to pay them. We don't know what the father's response was when they get out of the boat. And he's sitting there. Did he ask them to at least finish the nets, finish your day's work? Was he shocked? Is this so out of character for them? Did he cry at the departure of his sons? Right? This is a Jewish father. He had been very close to his sons. Did he say, "What am I supposed to tell your mother?" Did they have wives and children? This is why the calling of the two brothers hits a bit more for me, this imagery of their father alone in this boat. The lack of dialogue between Jesus and the newly called disciples is compelling. Jesus doesn't promise them stability or a good job. He doesn't say, "This is going to be so much fun." Doesn't even promise them they'll have a safe place to sleep at night or food to eat. Yet they immediately go with him when they're called. And they immediately go when they're called into the community of God. And we have to remember that these are already Jews, right? So what they're seeing is something even greater, something beyond just their religion already. Could we leave the security of our lives and the ways in which we guarantee our livelihoods like these guys, right? Could you be like Simon, Andrew, James, and John? I mean, we know that sometimes, because they're called the sons of thunder, we know that sometimes they see their mother again later. I'm looking at Sharon because we talked a lot during that first Lenten study about the brothers and the mother. But they don't know that at the time, right? Could we leave not knowing if we'd ever see our families again? Izzy, could you leave not knowing if you'd ever see your parents ever again? Probably. Wrong kid to ask. Sierra! Could you leave and never know if you would see your grandparents ever again? Oh, whoa. The story changed for Izzy. Story changed, right? Paul, could you just leave not knowing if you'd see those grandkids ever again? Julie, sorry, you might not be able to ever see Trevor ever again. That's not gonna happen. We know the Briggs would wrestle with this great-grandchild dilemma, right? This, how many greats are in this family now? So, and it's not to make anyone feel bad, right? Like, if I could never see my nieces and nephews again, it's a hard decision. Joe is not going to leave that grandchild, right? Like, it's not a character assassination on us. It's just how we form bonds with people. If you couldn't see your spouse. Patty, you can never see Larry again, at least that you know. You go and you stay in. I mean, she might be fine, especially if she and Susie could be the daughters of thunder, right? They already are. Oh, Kevin has gotten himself into trouble. They already are. Right? So Susie and Patty have been called the daughters of Gracie. Right? It would be hard. But we assume these guys probably had families. They were of the age. Of course, you were like past 15, you were of the age, really. But the way that they're spoken of in the Bible, they're definitely of the age. Would we ask some questions first? Carol Sector always has good questions. Carol, would you ask questions? Can I take a book? Is there a charger for a Kindle? Do I have to go today? Who said food? Yeah, Marsha, food, snacks. I know. When we just scheduled the Lenten study, I was like, oh, here come the snacks. Right? Megan, would you have any questions? I mean, I'd have questions. I think a good starter question was, what in the world is fishing for people? Fishing is called fishing because you try to catch what? What's it called if you try to catch people? Peopling? Peopling? That just sounds weird and inappropriate, maybe. I'm not sure. So it's a bit confusing to say, get out of this boat and I'll make you fish for some people. What does that even mean? Would we even want to know the details of this good news? The good news is among you. What does that mean? Right? These disciples answer this call so affirmatively given the lack of details. Would we have more to say? Like, okay, but let me just, like Carol, do I have to go today? Can I make a bit more money first in case this whole venture doesn't work out? Have a little nest egg over here. Or I need to talk to my family and make sure they're okay with this. How many of you, by a show of hands, make large life-changing decisions without consulting at least your spouse, your kids, your parents, or even a friend? Show of hands. Joe, you worry me. Winoka's used to it. Oh, before Winoka. Now, Joe? You're going to make some huge... not do it now. If Winoka's listening, he will not do it now. I mean, I at least need to call up one of my friends and be like, does this sound crazy? Right? Does this sound stupid? Because usually we have someone in our life who, I mean, George, are you going to go out tomorrow and buy a $70,000 car and not tell Pat first? Probably. Why not? Paul, you going to do that? Paul knows where his bread is buttered. Kevin did it once. He bought a new vehicle once. He just wants to make everyone know it was just once. Right? Butch, you gonna go buy a new house without letting Sandy know? Again, Butch knows where his bread is buttered, right? Normally, it's nice to inform people. I'm afraid to ask Ronnie and Julie. I'm afraid to know what Ronnie may have bought. Another piece of farm ground, 16 more pigs, like, right? But the point is, there's normally we have a conversation with someone we're close to, or Joe has Winoka tell him, no. Oh, you tell her no? And then she doesn't listen anyway. But you had the conversation. There you go. You had the conversation. Even without lots of details, these two brothers realize without hesitation that Jesus is the transformative presence, the power of God, and they completely change their lifestyles when they encounter him. Their priorities shift, and today we can look at that and go, Jesus is great, yes. How would we make that decision? And I think that's something we just wrestle with and know that maybe we wouldn't have made the same decision. And that's okay because we're not called to make that decision today. But these guys were called into being in a different way. A way that's scary to us, right, if we're honest. Leaving their family, their friends, their livelihoods, everything that's known to them to follow someone they don't even know into an unknown future. And we know it'll get scary. As we approach Lent and we go through the Passion, we know it gets scary. Ted A. Smith writes in Feasting on the Word Bible commentary that Mark begins like an alarm clock in the scripture, persistently declaring the time and demanding some response. Jesus as an alarm clock. Show of hands if you still own an alarm clock. I use an alarm clock and my phone. Who loves to hear their alarm clock go off in the morning? Wes? Alicia, you love to be woken up in the morning? She doesn't like it. So this is, let's see if I can find it. There, here's a sound that my dogs know means she's gonna get up and feed us. Right? If you have a phone and you use the alarm on it, you have like all of these really terribly obnoxious sounds you can choose. The iPhone, okay, if you have an iPhone, they're all obnoxious. I hear if you have an Android, some of them are pleasant. Yes. When we hear our alarms go off in the morning, we groan. Even if we don't have anything we have to go do, because we're so, like on a morning like this, we're so warm and comfy in our beds. We don't want to face a cold and snowy day, right? But Jesus as an alarm clock. Like one of those alarms. Anyone have one of those that starts out low and gets louder? And basically it gets so loud it's yelling at you like, hey, are you dumb? Do you not hear me? Right? I have one of those. You try to ignore it, but you can't. Jesus commanding that time is now for action on behalf of the realm. He commanded it for the disciples, and they followed him without the details. And he commands it from us, and we still don't have all the details. The difference being, we're not necessarily called to leave the people we love, right? We're not even necessarily called into hardship like they were. Imagine the financial hardship on their families. But Jesus is still calling us, commanding us into action on behalf of the realm. Is hitting the snooze button even an option? When Jesus says, it's time to get out of the boat. It's time to get out of bed. It's time to get out of your comfort zone. Is it even an option to use the snooze button when Jesus issues the call to discipleship? This ends this morning's word. We give thanks to God. Let us sing our communion hymn.
And
On the night that he was arrested, Jesus took the bread, gave thanks, blessed it, and broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup and he said, "This is the cup of the covenant for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." For as often as we take this bread and we take this cup, we proclaim his death until he comes again. The gifts of God for the children of God. All are welcome at the Lord's table. Let us pray.
Dear Holy Father, we can never be worthy enough to do that which we are about to do. We admit that we do not deserve to be invited to dinner at your house. Yet here at this table you receive us, and Christ offers his body and blood for us. We do not have to pass a test. We do not have to earn our way, and we do not have to pay for this privilege. For you in your grace have made us worthy. Bless us now as we bless these elements, this bread and this cup. Refresh us, restore us, and heal us as we partake. Guide us and challenge us as we try to live and witness in your name. Amen.
Let us take the bread and the cup.
Son and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send?
Are there any announcements?
Thanks to all of you's generosity. We've spent over $900 the last 2 weeks for the food pantry, and it's all because of you guys. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Continue to give. You can also drop off food out here. I'm assuming Paul might be willing to take food when Dave isn't around. The actual Paul, the actual Dave. Are there other announcements? On February 4th, which seems like a long way away, but it's not, we will be having a Laity Sunday. And so we would like the leadership of the church to be here to just install the board. We know it's been installed, but in a service. And then elders, trustees, if you can be here as well. I know Dave and Sharon won't be, but of course they are elders. And so if you are in leadership of any kind, hopefully you can be here on the 4th. If not, that's okay, I guess. We'll just dock you points for the year. Wes, you have an announcement, I'm sure, about this week.
I shared it 2 weeks ago, but a reminder, the new sound system will be getting installed. They start tomorrow morning, 8 o'clock, and they will be here every day, Monday through Friday, 8 to 5, working on stuff. So just a heads up, if you come around the church at that time, all the work is all happening in the sanctuary. And a reminder for those of us who are joining us online, I don't know 100% if we will be online next week because we'll be doing some training at the end of the week, but I don't know if we'll be fully versed to know to make it as effective as we can be for you folks online. But we will share via Facebook or otherwise, just heads up for that. If we won't be online, you'll know about it, and that will be because we'll be learning a whole new system, and it's ground up everything. So look forward to that.
Okay. It will be a good time. There's supposed to be ice sometime this week, I understand. So if they get delayed and say we don't have any sound for Sunday, because the weather, we'll let you know that too, and we'll just shift to online. but hopefully they can get that all done, even because then it's supposed to be like in the 40s, right? Or something. It's supposed to be like crazy. So any other announcements? And Wes will be here on and off all week. He's the one overseeing this project. So if there are none, let us say our benediction together. Gathered, we seek God in our lives. Gathered, we hear from God's word. Gathered, we sing our praises to God. Gathered, we commune at the Lord's table. Dispersed, we shall share the love of God with the world. Go in peace, go in love, be safe, and all God's children said, amen.